There are many ways to become a more productive programmer, and depending on who you ask, you'll hear many things, but there's one thing you probably don't hear often: the way you commit changes to your version control system. I'm not kidding. In this video, I'm going to tell you what atomic commits are, show you what they look like, why you want to use them, and give you some tips to get started. Let's go. First of all, the concept of atomic commits is not specific to version control systems. You may have heard of ACID transactions in the realm of databases, which I've always thought sounds absolutely badass. ACID, however, is just an acronym, and the A stands for atomicity, the thing we're interested in. The idea is that a set of statements is treated as a single unit. Each statement must be executed successfully for the transaction to be completed. To illustrate, let me give you the classic example. Let's say you want to transfer money from one bank account to another. In order to do that, we have to reduce the balance in one account and add it to the other. If one of these statements fails, we have an invalid state. Either money has vanished into thin air, or one account has received money that didn't exist before. Wrapping both statements into an ACID transaction guarantees that the transfer is either successful or doesn't happen at all. Nice. But what does all of this have to do with version control? Let's recap what we've just witnessed. There are multiple statements, but they are treated as a single operation. There are only valid states. The operation is either completed fully or not at all. There are only a few changes, and it's pretty obvious what's going on. If you saw this in a transaction log, you would know that it was a money transfer. Now, wouldn't it be nice if the commits in your repository were like this? Let's find out. But maybe, just for contrast, we start with something more common, a type of commit I've seen countless times in the wild. And this one has the innocent title @logout function. There's an app component and a test that was modified and a new component named login form. Now, when we take a look at the app component, we see that there's a lot going on. I mean, there is a logout function in there, but it also looks like pretty much every line in this component has been changed. Now, we could sit down and try to piece the changes together to form a coherent picture of what this commit is really about. Or we take a look at an alternative reality where the author has used atomic commits. So now we've got 6 commits instead of just one. Let's take a look. Okay, so the app component used to have a reset state method that wasn't used at all, so it was removed. That makes sense. The next one looks like there's a lot going on, but the commit message tells us all we need to know. It's just a refactoring from a class component to a function component. The class state has been replaced with state hooks, the login method is now a function, and the render method was turned into a return statement. Besides that, only the way status access has been changed. And that's pretty much it. There's no change in functionality. Simplify conditional logic also does exactly what it says. The Boolean expressions have been turned into a guard clause. I definitely like that better. Next, the login form was extracted into a separate component, so we got rid of the state to keep track of the credentials, and since we can't access them anymore, they must be passed into the login function. And when we scroll down, we see that a whole block of markup was replaced with a new component. Speaking of the new component, this looks nice and clean, and it does the same thing as before. Oh, and apparently there was a bug. So we've got new test cases and a very simple fix for a very sloppy mistake. And finally, the @logout function commit, and this time around it's really just that. A logout function and a corresponding test. That's it.
That was easy, right? And this is really the beauty of atomic commits. Now that we've seen a few examples, let's revisit the properties from earlier and see how they fit together with this. A commit may have multiple changes, but they're all part of a single operation. This could be a refactoring, a bug fix, or a new functionality. The important part is, it's just one of them. You don't mix. Whatever change you make, the result should be working software. You don't commit something that is only halfway done. It's gotta work. The number of changes should be manageable. You may wonder why I'm using something fuzzy like manageable amount instead of few changes. I'll get to that in a sec. And lastly, if you look at a commit, you should be able to get it in no time. The thing with 3 and 4 is that they seem related, right? Fewer changes, easier to get, more changes, harder to get. But this is not always the case. Let's say you work on a big Java project and you have to move one widely used class to a different package. Your commit may change hundreds of classes because the import of the class you moved has to be changed in all usages. However, the commit is still easy to get. It's basically the same change over and over again. But if you work on a feature that requires several functional changes, your commit may only change 4 classes, but because of the complexity, it's not easy to understand. So I guess I could have merged manageable amount and comprehensible into something like limited complexity and it would have worked as well, but I didn't because I liked it this way. But you don't have to, so feel free to disagree. Speaking of which, I'm almost certain that some people will disagree with what I'm showing you in this video. Some will prefer the first example and say if it had a bullet list of all changes in the body of the commit message, it would have been pretty much the same with the advantage of being a single commit, because fewer commits equal fewer parts to deal with, maybe. Some will say I should have made 3 commits, all refactorings combined, the bug fix, and the new functionality. And others will have other opinions on the number of commits and what should go into each. I don't want to claim what I did is the definite and only way to do it, but I'm doing it for a reason. But how exactly does making more commits for the same amount of changes make me more productive? One important lesson I've learned over the years is that certain things slow me down, and the two major ones are complexity and having too much on my plate. The longer I work on something, the more open loops I have to juggle, and the more changes I accumulate, the harder it gets to keep track of everything. The cognitive load gets too high, and it doesn't even have to be crazy high. If it's always a little too much, it compounds over the course of a day. And of course, you're not supposed to do that, right? Everybody knows you should break down work properly and stay on track with the task at hand. It sounds so good on paper, but let's be honest, it's easy to get carried away. I love this quote by Kent Beck. I'm not a great programmer, I'm just a good programmer with great habits. And using atomic commits is exactly this to me, a great habit. Once it's in place, you constantly scan for isolated changes, things you can finish and commit that'll bring you closer to finishing the whole task. You get really creative and look for ways to break something down even further to get it out of the way. And this is really addictive. This may sound like cheating, making things smaller just for the sake of committing and creating the illusion of progress and productivity, but I don't think it is. To me, it's about creating momentum. Building small parts that work to build something bigger, constantly moving forward. Again, you can achieve the same without atomic commits, but they really force you to stay in this laser-focused, finish one thing at a time mode, and this alone is reason enough for me to keep doing it. But there's more. Making atomic commits will leave you with a cleaner and more readable history. If you work with pull requests or you have other forms of code reviews, it will be easier to understand a set of changes when they are spread out in a clean and logical way. Likewise, tracing down bugs can be easier. If you already know the area, you can narrow down the commits and get rid of all the unrelated changes. And if you don't, you can use tools like git bisect to find the commit that introduced the bug and you'll get a clearly scoped one. If you work on a team, conflicts are inevitable, but atomic commits will be easier to resolve. Because each commit has a clear objective, you know what you have to look for when merging changes. It should also come as no surprise that atomic commits are easier to revert. You don't have to pull apart a bigger commit to get rid of the stuff that you don't want. But how to get started? Well, I mean, the obvious answer is just do it. I'm sure you've got the concept by now. It's really not hard to get, just hard to get used to it. But here are a few tips that'll hopefully make it a little easier. Hey, Kent Beck again. If you haven't heard of his two hats metaphor, it's like this. When you're programming, there are two modes, or hats. Refactoring and adding functionality. You should do only one of those things at a time. So be aware of which hat you're wearing, and if you change hats, it's definitely time to commit. If you can't summarize what you've done in a couple of words or you have to use and, it most likely means that you've made too many changes. In this case, split up the changes and make multiple commits. Did you notice that I always talked about adding functionality and never about adding features? It's because features will typically be too big for a single commit. For example, in a web app you may have changes in the markup, styles, controller, domain logic and model, persistence layer, and whatnot. I get that it would be nice to have all this in one commit. The feature is not there, the feature is there. That's Atomic too, right? It is. And some features might be small enough for that, but when they're not, you lose all the other benefits I've been talking about. So my advice is decompose a feature and commit its parts individually. For some people, letting go is a problem. They don't want to make a commit unless everything is perfect, or at least good enough. And to be clear, I'm not talking about a culture where people mock each other for the code they write. There's no room for such behavior in a team. What I'm talking about can happen even if somebody works on their own. Instead of moving on to the next part, they slow down to improve something that already works. Or worse, they have a solution in mind, but they don't want to write it down because they think it's not good enough. So they freeze in front of the computer and kill all the momentum and the type of productivity I'm talking about. Now, I don't want to suggest that you shouldn't improve existing code or that you shouldn't think about alternative solutions. But sometimes it's just our imaginary bar that we want to clear. Our pride gets in the way. What we really should be doing is moving on, and when the big picture emerges and things fall into place, we'll eventually know what to do. But even if not, we can still sit down and think about it once we've run out of other tasks or if it has become a problem. Having said that, there are situations where you have to change gears, and one of them is when you don't know how to build the thing you want to build. This might seem obvious, but sometimes when people want to adopt a new technique, they try to force it. This is a major point of frustration for people starting out with test-driven development because it doesn't work if you don't know what you're building. And this is related to atomic commits because every commit that contains a change in functionality should be covered by tests. Remember, only valid states. And you don't want to verify each commit manually, do you? But the following advice holds true even if you're not a TDD person. If you don't know how to build something, explore. Create a prototype and play around until you know. And once you know, start over and things will be easy, or, I mean, at least easier. Even with your best intentions, sooner or later you'll end up with a working copy that has way too many changes. It is tempting to keep it that way. Just commit, vow to improve, and then move on. But I think it's better to go the extra mile and clean up. It's a good exercise, and even if you've been using atomic commits for a while, you'll still end up in this situation once in a blue moon. So it's good to be efficient at separating changes. So this is it. I hope you've got something out of this video. If you did, and even if you didn't, please let me know. This is the first time I've made a video like this, so feedback is much appreciated. If you liked it, hit like, share it, whatever you deem appropriate, and if you want to see more of this, consider subscribing. Thanks for watching and see you next time.